Expecting you, come in. Sit down. So, you've got some questions to ask us.
Janet, como você se tornou bruxa?
How did I become a witch? Why did I enter this very strange path, which has now become so popular that it is one of the fastest growing religions in the world? In 1970, just before my 20th birthday, a friend of mine became very interested in the subject of witchcraft. At that time, I worked in the music industry, and so as far as I was concerned, witchcraft was sex, drugs, and rock and roll. And I had absolutely no interest in the subject whatsoever. I'd been brought up a good Christian, and at that time I was also a part-time Sunday school teacher. So my instinct was to actually go and save my friend's soul. It was a result of that that introduced me to the path that I have followed ever since. Because of her actions, I met Alexanders, the so-called King of the Witches. And at the same time, the man who was to become my future husband, the late Stuart Farrar. When we met Alex, myself and my friend, my first reaction was that here was a religion that actually made a lot of sense. It complemented my Christian beliefs that I had grown up with, and at the same time, it opened whole different avenues to a greater world perspective. As a result of what happened later, she left the craft and I stayed, and of course married Stuart. Stuart and I only stayed with Sanders for a year. And during that year, he gave us our first, second, and third degrees. At the age of 20, achieving third degree, at the time, seemed a miracle. I had gone from being nobody to a witch queen. My views today on such subjects are very, very different, because I do not believe that anyone at the age of 20 who has had very little life experience can call themselves a high priest or high priestess or a magus or a witch queen. These degrees have to be earned with life experience.
Gavin, fale-nos pouco mais sobre você.
Hi, my name's Gavin Bone. So really, I'm going to start talking about my origins. Janet's origins are very well known with Alexander's, but very few people really know where I came from as such. When I was 18, I started to put together what the best way of explaining it is my own religion. I started taking bits and pieces from other religions out there, for instance Hinduism. I like the concept of the gods and goddesses in Hinduism representing the forces in nature, so I absorbed that into my own religion. Buddhism, the idea of karma, the idea of reincarnation, I absorbed that into my own religion. Taoism, the polarity of yin and yang, that made sense to me. I saw that in the universe around me, so I absorbed that into my religion. And I took bits here, bits there, bits that made sense to me. And it wasn't until later on that I picked up a book by Doreen Valiente, a book called ABC of Witchcraft. And I realised what she was writing about was actually my religion, that that I wasn't alone, that there were other people out there who had the same beliefs as myself. After that, I realized what I was. I realized I was Wiccan. Now, that was in England in the early 80s, and there were very few contact networks at that time. The Pagan Federation really wasn't that well organized. So I pretty much carried on doing my own thing for quite a while, but reading as much as I could. Of course, I picked up various books, including Janet and Stuart's books, books by Ray Buckland, and there weren't many books around at that time. I mean, now you go into a bookshop and there are shelves just full of books on Wicca. Back in the early 80s, there would have been half a shelf at most. And most of those were not on Wicca. They were occult subjects, high magic, astrology. It was in 1985 that I came across an occult shop in my hometown. It had just opened. And I went in there. And I had a tarot reading done. And I became aware that there was actually a group working in the shop. Now that was a very eclectic group. It was doing a mixture of ceremonial magic and earth magic, working with ley lines and earth energies. And I became involved with that group. I had at that time come across several other people who were interested in Wicca. And it resulted in 1986 in a group of us forming a Saxe Wicca coven in Portsmouth, my hometown. Now, Saxe Wicca is a tradition created by Ray Buckland. It's what's called Reconstructionist. It is an attempt to reconstruct a tradition from ancient times, in the case of Saxe Wicca of the Anglo-Saxons. So I was originally initiated into Saxe Wicca. Well, I knew things weren't going to go right for me when the young lady who later became my wife, she was supposed to initiate me as a Jesuit, which is Anglo-Saxon word for priest, but unfortunately it came out wrong, and it came out as Jesuit. So as far as I know, I'm the only Jesuit in Wicca. And that's really how I started, very humble roots. As time went on, I began to meet other people, some of them from various mainstream traditions, who told me that I wasn't a witch, because I wasn't properly initiated, but I knew I was. I knew what I was. Well, by that time, myself and my wife, who was my original initiator, we got together. We were married. And we ended up forming our own coven. And we weren't trained by any group. We just did our own thing. We did what felt right. And very soon, we had people wanting to join. And we started to initiate people, and it started to work. Again, we continually met other people, and at different times I had contact with other traditions. I was initiated into what's called Dorset Traditional, which is really just Gardnerian. I was, for a short period, working alongside some members of a coven who were originally initiated by Sybil Leake in the New Forest. So I got an understanding of what went on in the traditional covens in the New Forest, and the surprising thing was, it wasn't much. They didn't have much material. In fact, this couple were using a lot of material from Janet and Stuart's books to fill in the gaps. So that's really my origins.
Como que Gerald Gärtner e depois Alexanders começaram o movimento da arte como nós conhecemos hoje?
To understand how we came to this point in time with Wicca, how it's developed, we have to go back to the 1950s and the 1940s. Modern Wicca starts with a man called Gerald Gärtner. Now, Gerald Gärtner was a customs official who lived in Ceylon, what is now known as Sri Lanka. Now, after he moved to the Middle East, to the Far East, he became very, very interested in the mysticism. In fact, he even wrote a paper on the kris, the knife, which is traditional to Indonesia. It is a shaman's knife. And it's probably where we get the idea of many of the traditional aspects of the Athemi from. Now, so he was very interested in magic and mysticism. In the 1940s, with the advent of the Second World War, Gerald Gardner moved back to England. And he moved to an area on the south coast of England called the New Forest. Now, he was a naturist. This was a very big fashion in England in the 1920s and 1930s. There were naturist camps appearing everywhere. And one of these had opened up in the New Forest, just outside of a place called Lyndhurst. So he used to frequent there regularly. It was while he was frequenting the naturist camp that he probably met some of the first occultists in the New Forest. And these were Rosicrucians, because in Christchurch, nearby to Lyndhurst, there was the first Rosicrucian Theatre of England, as it was called. So Gardner became involved with the Rosicrucian Theatre in Ringwood. It is very likely from there that he met members of what he called the New Forest Coven. Now, this is probably going to upset some people. The fact is, there probably never was really a New Forest Coven. The people he met were members of an organisation called the Fellowship of Crotona. Now, the Fellowship of Crotona was co-Masonic. It was Gnostic Christian. Many of the practices of that group were probably nowadays what we would call ceremonial magic, high magic. So, but you see, Gardner was a reader. He read a lot of the books for the period. And one of them was Margaret Murray's The God of the Witches and the Witch Cult in Western Europe. Now, a lot of academics actually scoff at her works, saying that there is no evidence for any survivals of witch cult. But Gardner believed there was. And when he became involved in the Fellowship of Crotona, it is very likely he believed that the Fellowship of Crotona was practicing witchcraft. Now, that got him into a lot of trouble, because certainly back in the 1940s, the word witch was a loaded term. So he probably fell out of favour very quickly with the Fellowship of Crotona and its membership, because he kept calling them witches and saying how they were the survivors of a witch cult. Now, when he published his first book, High Magic's Aid, I think that was really enough. They'd really had enough, and they actually threw him out of the group. But he continued to believe there was some sort of witch cult out there. And he actually ended up creating it himself. He was so desperate for recognition for what he was starting to create that he even went to Aleister Crowley and got involved with Aleister Crowley and got Aleister Crowley to actually write some of the rituals for him. Not many people realise that the Charge of the Goddess in Wicca today has its origins not just with Aubyn Valienti, but also with Aleister Crowley as the Levator Vestlis. And certainly he paid Aleister Crowley a sum of money for a charter to align Wicca with the Ordo Templi Orientis, Aleister Crowley's order. So Gardner went about creating what he was looking for. Now, come the 1950s, people have got over the Second World War and they're beginning to reject many of the values that existed in pre-war Britain. And people are getting interested in the occult again. So people start to join his coven. One of those people was a woman called Aubyn Valienti. And she looked at all the material that he had, and she looked at, because Gardner took a lot of material from several different writers of the period, including Crowley. And she said, well, you know, Gerald, none of this makes any sense. And what she did is she ordered it all. She put it all together so it worked. And she added the prose and the rhyme, the poetry. So if you call Gerald Gardner the father of modern witchcraft, Aubyn Valienti is the mother. And she is just important as a figure as Gerald Gardner. Now she actually, like many of his high priestesses, fell out with him and ended up going off and doing her own thing. But what is important about Gardner is this. He started things rolling. He started things moving. And you have to remember this. Before Gardner, to be involved in the occult in Britain, you had to be upper class. You had to be wealthy and you had to have money. What Gardner did is brought it down from the upper class to the middle class. And when Alexander's came along, he took it the next step. He took it from the middle class down to the lower classes, the working class. What those two gentlemen did, Gerald Gardner and Alexander, is open up the occult world to everybody. Because before them, you had to be aristocracy. You had to be upper class. And this is what they should be best remembered for opening things up. The mistake people make is seeing them as saints. They aren't. They were men of their time doing the best that they could.
Janet, o que você poderia nos falar sobre Alexanders?
Alexanders, the so-called King of the Witches, lived most of his life and I believe was born in Manchester in the north of England. What is known factually about him is that he became very interested in the craft and he chased one of Gardner's priestesses, Patricia Crowther, who was one of Gardner's original and great priestesses. He wanted to join her coven. Patricia took an instant dislike to the man and refused to have him initiated. There are letters which prove, which are, I believe, in Pat's hands to this very day, letters that prove that he tried to get into her coven. Up until that time, he was not a witch. It was through one of her renegade priestesses, a lady called Pat Kapinski, that he actually got into the craft and became initiated. His claims were that, in actual fact, his Welsh grandmother, Grandma Biddy, and Biddy is a nickname for anyone with the name Bridget. Well, he claimed that his Welsh grandmother initiated him when he was a pubescent child, that one day he came home and he found her in the kitchen, stripped naked, muttering spells and incantations around a cauldron, that she took hold of him, stripped him naked, dragged him into the circle, nicked his scrotum with a black-handled knife with the athame, in other words, and initiated him into the craft. As we say today, that's child abuse. His story, of course, is totally fabricated, and even his wife, Maxine, confirmed that to myself and Stuart. But this was the kind of person that Alexanders was. He would come up with legends and myths about himself that had no basis whatsoever in reality. Which is a shame, because he could have been a very genuinely gifted man. He certainly had charisma. He certainly had charm. He had knowledge, but all his knowledge was gained from books and other people's works, which he never accredited to them, much to Stuart's annoyance. People like Franz Baden, for example. So he would use other people's work and illustrate it as his own. And this was the tragedy of Alexanders. The teachings that he gave, as I said, were from other people's work and other people's books. In many ways, our gift that he left us, and it was his legacy, was the fact he opened up the craft to so many people. And he introduced teaching. You see, in the old days with Gerald Gardner, there were no teachings inside the covens. This was purely instigated by Sanders. This was his legacy, that he took the craft forward. But, as I said, it was not witchcraft.
Opiniões sobre Alexanders variam consideravelmente. Ele foi chamado de grande mago, charlatão, rei das bruxas e por muitos outros nomes. Qual a sua opinião pessoal sobre ele e sobre o seu trabalho?
Many people have said, was he genuinely the king of the witches? The answer to that is no. There is only one king of the witches and only one queen of the witches. And those are the lord and lady themselves. Was he a charlatan? Yes, in many ways he was a charlatan. Did he believe in the gods, and specifically in the goddess? Yes, he did, with his entire heart. The goddess meant very much to Mr. Sanders. But, for all his gifts, he was never able to escape the fact that he was a showman through his entire life, from the day he first became a witch to the day he died. He, like many other people in the craft during that period, were not practicing witchcraft. They were practicing a mixture of ceremonial magic, pagan folklore, and a mishmash of hermetics, Kabbalah, and other systems. They bore as much relation to witchcraft as a Christian might today. For you see, witchcraft is only really just being discovered. And although it was people like Gardner and Saunders who gave us the rebirth of witchcraft, it has been the development ever since that is the real key to magic and the mysteries.
Alguns bruxos tradicionais afirmam que homossexuais não podem fazer parte da bruxaria porque a arte é uma religião de fertilidade. Qual a sua opinião sobre isso? Você aceitaria gays no seu coven?
One of the problems that has arisen in the craft is down to fundamentalism, pagan fundamentalism. And one of the biggest questions that is argued inside the craft is homosexuality. As we are a nature-based religion based on the polarity of male and female, do homosexuals, either lesbians or gays, belong inside the craft? The answer is emphatically yes, they do. And they certainly belong in heterosexual covens. Some of the greatest priests I've ever known inside the craft have been gay. And there is a reason for that. They have the god and goddess balanced so well within them, the anima and the animus, that they are able to understand the magic and the mysteries, often long before their heterosexual counterparts. Doreen Valiente herself, for many years, did not feel that homosexuality had a place in witchcraft. Many years later, she publicly stood on stage and said, "I was wrong." That gays are very, very much part of the old religion. They always have been and they always will be. And I have been proud to have them inside my covens. So much so that back in the 1980s I lost an entire coven here in Ireland who could not handle the concept of homosexuality inside the craft. My crime that I was put on trial for, along with Stuart, was initiating two homosexuals. And I must say I am very pleased we went through that, because it justified everything I felt, that the gay population and the craft go hand in hand.
Algumas pessoas acham que a arte se tornou muito dogmática nos últimos tempos. As pessoas se tornaram muito estritas, chegando ao ponto de seguir cada palavra do Livro das Sombras e seus rituais. Você tem percebido isso na Wicca? E se sim, você acha que a bruxaria progressiva pode ajudar um pouco a mudar essa situação?
People talk of traditional covens, saying that this is not traditional. I am sorry, there are no traditional covens left. That includes Welsh, Scottish, European. Any people who call themselves traditional covens are lying through their teeth. There are family folk memories, but they have been incorporated into Christian concepts. You will see that in Italy with the Stregheria, the Italian witches. In Wales, You'll find it amongst the Druid community. You see, witchcraft is a modern revival. And all that was left in the old family traditions were folklore memories. And the practice went underground and emerged as Christian. You see that in other parts of the world, as Santeria, in Voodoo, but not in witchcraft. And this is what we are regaining today, our true magical traditions.
Quais seus pensamentos sobre auto-iniciação e auto-dedicação?
The question of self-initiation or self-dedication. It was Doreen Valiente, who Stuart and I got to know as a very dear friend, who advocated the concept of self-initiation. Technically, she was right, but technically, she was wrong. You see, although we have written about it in our many books, and Stuart and I together wrote over 10 books on the subject of witchcraft, including The Witch's Bible, The Witch's God, The Witch's Goddess, Spells and How They Work, The Pagan Path, Life and Times of a Modern Witch, etc., etc., we discussed in these books the concept of self-initiation. But it's only as time went by that we suddenly realized there is no such thing. If you stand inside a magic circle that you have created on your own, with nobody else around you, and you self-dedicate or self-initiate, it is not you who initiates. It is the gods. The Lord and the Lady initiate you. You take an oath to them to become their priest or priestess. That is your dedication. They are your initiators. And that is the secret, that there is but one initiator. And that one initiator is the supreme power of the universe. And believe me, if you do it properly, that initiation will work. You may not get immediately what you want, but you get what you need. And that means that that initiation might change your life forever. The gods have a habit of putting you where they want you and giving you the tasks that they want you to perform. And that is the true secret of any initiation, for not even your high priest and high priestess can initiate you. Only the gods can genuinely do that.
Qual a sua visão sobre alguns rituais considerados controvertidos, como o Grande Rito e o Açoitamento? Eles ainda são realizados por você? Se sim, qual o seu significado? Eles são simbólicos?
In the days of Gerald Gardner, One of the most infamous aspects of the craft was his desire for ritual scourging, nudity, binding, and the Great Rite. In the early days, the Great Rite was always sexual, between a high priest and high priestess. As his priestesses grew and developed, eventually, Doreen Valiente came along. And Doreen saw things very differently. It was Doreen who invented the symbolic Great Rite, because let us be honest, I'm not sure I would have come into the craft if sexual initiation had been part of it. In fact, I know I most certainly would not have done. Doreen felt very much the same way, and through her inspiration, a new form of the Great Rite was developed.
We have a standing joke in our coven. The reason we don't have the scourge on the altar is because the scourge is about art thou willing to suffer to learn. And the problem is most of our coven members would enjoy it too much, so we don't have the scourge on the altar anymore. We do, on specific occasions, go skyclad, but that is not all the time. We certainly don't go with the old idea that having your clothes off allows more energy to flow, because quite simply, if your clothes can keep the energy in, it can't be very strong energy. We certainly don't have the Great Rite performed publicly within the coven. In fact, most of the coven members are in steady relationships with partners who they work with. And certainly, if they perform any form of sex magic, it's something private. It is not something which is done publicly within the coven for everybody.
Gavin, vocês viajaram por muitos países nos últimos anos, particularmente os Estados Unidos. Como você diria que esses países são diferentes no que diz respeito ao Wicca? E existe alguma diferença significativa? Algum deles é mais tolerante?
Witchcraft is different everywhere. Wherever you go around the world, Wicca has developed in a different way. There is a very, very good reason for this. Wicca is a nature-based religion, which means it obeys the natural law, and the most important natural law is one of evolution, basically survival. What makes an animal survive is adapting to its environment, and it's the same with Wicca. Wicca adapts to its environment. For example, in Australia, it's pointless doing the normal cycle of eight festivals as you would in Northern Hemisphere, because in the Southern Hemisphere, summer is actually during our winter months, as you know in Brazil. So, for instance, summer solstice in Australia is actually at Christmas. So you see that evolution taking place. Also, the culture has an impact. For example, in Australia, the culture is what's called an extreme culture because of the temperature, the environment. The Australians are very into dangerous sports. So they tend to have a more extreme culture. And it's the same in Wicca. Wicca tends to be more extreme in Australia. They're more likely to experiment. So Wicca is different everywhere, and it's supposed to be like that. Just in the same way that the wildlife is different in every country. The cultures are different in every country because of the temperatures, because of the landscape. It's the same with Wicca. Another example, what would the point be of worshipping a corn king in a country when there's no corn? So you go to countries and they don't have a corn king, they use another figure which they have developed. Again, there is this evolution in different places with Wicca. America, without doubt, is probably evolving the fastest for several reasons. One of those is the nature of the culture, it being so open. American culture encourages you to experiment. So not surprisingly, what started off as a very British movement very quickly, by the 1980s, had become principally spearheaded by the Americans. So you see a lot of American books out there. Unfortunately, a lot of them are rubbish. They're pulp, but there are some good writers and some good books. So America is now spearheading the witchcraft movement. If there are new ideas occurring, they're coming out of America. They're not coming out of England. Sure, there will be good ideas come out of England. There will be good ideas come out of Australia. But it's America who seems to be leading the way now. They certainly seem more tolerant towards each other within the witchcraft movement. Yes, they do have the reverse. They have those Wiccans who are very strict and dogmatic. But on the whole, it's very tolerant. It's a young, vibrant culture. And Wicca, it doesn't matter where we go in the States, we find Wiccans. Even though practices might be different between different countries, certainly within Wicca, the views, the ethics, the morality, the philosophy between different countries really isn't that much different. It is those that are important in Wicca, those that actually bind us all together. We might practice different traditions. We might practice in the Northern Hemisphere. Some might practice in the Southern Hemisphere. But it is the fact that we share a common philosophy that is important within Wicca, not how we practice. It is the morals, the ethics, and the philosophy that are important.
Janet, que conselho você daria para alguém que está chegando agora no paganismo ou na bruxaria?
What I personally give to somebody who is interested in witchcraft. My first piece of advice would be to read every book you can on the subject that you can get your hands on and realize that not everything you read is factual. Secondly, study other subjects outside witchcraft. Study mythology, study medicine, study astronomy, study the sciences, study geology. All of these things will take a practical aspect as your life goes by as a witch. The most important thing of all, if you decide to join a group and you are asked to do anything that you find abhorrent, walk away. If they threaten you, ignore them. Just walk away. You are a free agent, and that will always be the will of the gods for your self-development as a witch. Remember, no man or woman can control you. You have to learn to control yourself. If they ask for money and try to extort it from you, think twice. In our own coven, we have what we call the Coven Fund. We put a jar on the table, and every coven meeting, €1 or €2 go into that jar to buy candles and to buy food. But that is all. We do not charge for our services in our coven. We are a family. You do not charge your family for your services. We treat each other as equals, and that is the way a true coven should be run. There should be no man or woman standing up and saying, "Obey me." They should ask, "Please, could you, for example, clean the coven kit? Could you, darling, please make me a cup of tea? Please, can you help look after the other coven members?" As a family, that is the way a coven should be and how it should react. There are too many people out there with large egos who want to be great queens and great kings of witchcraft. If you come across them, walk away. They have no knowledge and no power, and they are not of the old religion.
Janet Farrar, Gavin Bone, quero agradecer muitíssimo a entrevista que vocês nos concederam e quero aproveitar a oportunidade para convidar todas as pessoas para estarem conosco agora no dia 14 de setembro, lá no auditório da Rádio Mundial, na Avenida Paulista 2200, a partir das 18h30, para conferir o lançamento da Bíblia das Bruxas. O lançamento traz aí um grande presente, porque nós teremos uma videoconferência ao vivo com a Janet Farrar diretamente da Irlanda. Então, pela primeira vez, né, a Bíblia das Bruxas sendo publicada no Brasil, como eu sempre digo, uma pessoa não é wiccaniana até ler a Bíblia das Bruxas. Então, finalmente, esse livro chega para a gente aqui no Brasil e com um presente maravilhoso, com uma videoconferência ao vivo com a Janet Farrar, e todo mundo vai poder fazer perguntas, tirar dúvidas, vai ser muito gostoso. Estamos esperando por todas as pessoas que estão vendo esse vídeo. E olha, mais uma vez, Janet Gavin, muitíssimo obrigado por essa entrevista. Um beijo e estamos esperando vocês aqui no Brasil.
Merry meet,
Merry Pot.
and merry meet again.
Thanks for coming by, friends. Hope to see you again soon. Bye!